كان كويس فصل إن شاء الله تعالى كده من الجامس الجامس تعملت الأطباق. We have three last etiquettes on the Adam Dashar. إن شاء الله تعالى كده.
Seeking permission, and seeking permission, what does it
What are you seeking permission for? To enter where specifically? What are the places that you seek permission to enter? A place that has a known only that the doors are shut, like a home or an office, etc. The doors are normally shut. But places where the doors are left normally open, you don't have to seek permission. You may enter without seeking permission. But other places like that, you must seek permission before entering. What is the time of seeking permission? When do you seek permission? At what time?
Before
entrance. Before you enter. And not after. You don't enter without seeking permission. But you must seek permission before. The second matter. Now, to stand on the right or the left of the door. And what is the reason for that? To protect the awlat of the people, the privacy of the people, so that you don't see anything that you're not allowed to see that is unlawful. Number three.
If you're granted permission, you enter.
If you're granted permission, that's when you only enter, right? And the words that indicate that you're granted permission are many, and that goes back to the customs of the people, the language that you speak. In the Arabic language, it may be said to you, udkhul, enter. It may be said to you, ta'al, come. It may be said to you, tafaddal, go ahead, etc. Okay? And that goes back to the urf or the adab. Now, what's the fourth?
If it's said to you, return, then you should return.
If it's said to you to return, then you must return. Right? And what's the reason for why do you have to return? It's a command from Allah Azza wa Jal. He Jalla wa Ala says, وَإِنْ قِيلَ لَكُمْ رُجِعُوا فَرُجِعُوا in Surah An-Nur. And if it's said to you, return, then you must return. Right? And the people who are asked to return, they are of two situations. What are the two situations? Now. Now. Rujur. And returning with tibbiness, with pleasure, right? And without feeling any pain. Because again, this is a command from Allah, and you don't feel any ill feelings towards the individual who asked you to return. And the second situation, it is returning with khubth nafs, a filthy nafs, meaning that it's as if you are rejecting the command of Allah as if. Okay, with alam, without feeling pain. And this is in contradiction to the Sharia. While the first is in accordance to the Sharia now. The third etiquette, what was it? The etiquette of what? And how eating good. And which, how many masail were in this matter? How many matters?
Six.
Six. What's the first? Saying Bismillah before you eat and drink, okay? And which is, this is at the beginning, before, once you started, before you started to eat, you say Bismillah. The second, could be a meaning. Bismillah, okay, what is the best form of saying the Tasmiyah before eating? Bismillah. What are other ways that you could say the Tasmiyah? Yes, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, or along those lines, using any other of the Asma of Allah Azza wa Jal al-Husna. Okay? But this is less virtuous than saying Bismillah, because Bismillah, it was sarih, it was mentioned specifically in the riwayah of Tabarani in Hadith of Umar ibn Abi Salam radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. The Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام said, Ya Ghulam, قل بسم الله. O young boy, say Bismillah. So, مُقْتَصِرًا عَلَيْهَا, saying it only Bismillah, it is better than أَتِ عَلِمْ الرَّحْمَنْ الرَّحِيمْ الْكَرِيمْ الرَّزَّاقْ etc. Now, the second matter we said is eating, the third matter, it is eating with your right, eating with your right hand. Now, the fourth matter it is. What is the fourth matter?
You have to close the street.
To in that which is closest to you. He said that what is closest to you is defined, and what does it mean by eating what is that which is closest to you? When it's one dish, we talk about one form of food. One dish, if what has been shared, you eat from what is closest to you. Or if the table with only one portion of food, you eat from that which is closest to you. But if there are different rice or different food, then you can eat from any part of that table. Or if you're eating by yourself, then you can eat from any side of your plate. Now, the fifth mas'ala. If you are finished, then you lick your fingers, right? Or you can lick the utensils that you use, the fork, the knife, and the spoon. Now, number six. Say alhamdulillah. Now, we mentioned that Allah Azza wa Jal, He's pleased with the servant when he eats the food and he praises him, when he drinks the drink and he praises him. Now, the fourth etiquette. What is the etiquette of speech? Okay, how do you say? Seven, what are they? Pass quickly. First one? Good speech. The second one? The third one? The fourth? The fifth?
Facing
the individual. The sixth?
Not
interrupting. The seventh?
Not
receiving what? Okay. Tayyib, the adab al khamis. The fifth etiquette. What is the fifth etiquette to change? Actually, the etiquette of sleeping. I don't know. And how many masail are this adab in this etiquette? Eight. What is the first? To make wudu when you go to sleep. Number two?
Right side.
Sleep on your right side. Number three? Ayat al-Kursi. Recite Ayat al-Kursi. Number four? To gather your hands together. Number five? Right. And you blow into it, right? Number six? To blow into it. Number seven?
Why
your body? Number eight? The sixth etiquette, what is it pertaining to?
Sneezing.
The etiquette of sneezing, how many say?
Four.
What are the four? What's number one?
Covering
your face with what?
Hand.
Your hand or clothing, which hand specifically?
Right.
Why?
Dirty things.
It's considered dirty. Yes. Is it considered dirty in the Sharia or in the customs? That is, طبعا, the nature of the people. Number two. Say Alhamdulillah, he sneezed. Number three. Say Alhamdulillah, who sneezed. Number four. Saying Yahdikum Allah, Subhabalakum, to the one who said to you, Alhamdulillah. Are you allowed to perform this dua in any other forms?
Yes.
What's the evidence for that? From the companions, the Sahaba. Like who? Ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar. And who else?
Ibn Abbas,
radiallahu anhuma. And what were the dua they used to make? Anyone remember the statements that they used to make when Umar used to say?
وإياكم ويغفر الله لنا ولكم.
نعم. May Allah have mercy upon us and you, and may Allah forgive us and you. What did Ibn Abbas used to say? Do you remember?
يرحمنا ويرحمكم.
يرحمنا ويرحمكم الله. May Allah have mercy upon us and have mercy upon you. Now, what is mercy to say?
يهديكم
الله, because this was narrated in the So the Messenger Ali Sultan, but it's permissible to say what the Sahaba said, it's permissible to make any other dua as well. That is good. طيب, now we come to the seventh etiquette. Okay.
السابع رد الثائب ما استطعت وأمسك بيدك على فيك ولا تقل
The seventh is pertaining to the etiquette of yawning. And he says, حَفِظَهُ اللَّهُ عَزَّهُ وَفَقَى He says, رَدُّ التَّثَاؤُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتَ returning or repelling or restraining the yawn as much as you can, as an etiquette. That if you are about to yawn, that you restrain it. You hold it back and you don't let it out. Okay, as much as you can. وَأَمْسِكْ بِيَدِكَ عَلَى فِيكَ. And hold your mouth with your hand. Okay? وَلَا تَقُلْ. And don't say, ah, ah, when you're yawning. Don't make a sound when you're yawning. It's a very bad etiquette to make a sound. And this etiquette, أَدَبُ التَّفَاءُ, the etiquette of yawning has three مَسَائِل. It has three matters pertaining to it. The first مسألة, it is في قوله رَدُّ التَّفَاءُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتَ. التَّفَاءُ, this is هو خروج هواء من الفم دون نفخ. It is yawning, it is air coming out of the mouth without blowing. Air that comes out from the mouth without blowing. This is what yawning or tata'u is defined in Arabic language. So if this happens, this air is pushing out, the individual must repel it and restrain it as much as he can. He must restrain it as much as he can. And he restrains it. The yawn. And he doesn't only restrain it, but he hides it. He hides it. He hides the fact that he's about to yawn. This is from the etiquette. The second mas'ala. And the reason, the first mas'ala, going back to it, the reason why he hides it is because when someone yawns, the state he looks, it is dislike to the people, the way he looks when he's yawning. With his mouth wide open and his face looking a sort of way. It is very unattractive. And because of that, he hides as much as he can. This is from etiquette. The second mas'ala, it is في قوله وَأَمْسِكْ بِيَدِكَ عَلَى فِيكَ. And hold your mouth with your hand. Which is grabbing your mouth with your hand. Okay? Putting or holding back the yawn. If you aren't able to restrain the yawn from coming out of the first place, then you must restrain it with your hand. And place your hand over your mouth. And the best way of placing your hand over your mouth when you're yawning, it is depending on the situation. What suits the situation? Okay, if your mouth, it is clean and there's nothing dirty within it, then you use your right hand. Okay, and it does not have also any bad odors coming out of your mouth, then you use your right hand. And you don't only use your right hand, but you use the back of your right hand. Use the back, you place it over your mouth like this. Because the inner part uses to eat or use to shake the hands of the people. So you use the back of the hand and you place that over your mouth. That is how you cover the yawn. However, if your mouth, it is dirty, or if the mouth, it has bad odors coming out from it, then you use the left hand. The left hand is used, and you cover the left hand and use the back of the left hand as well. Use the back of the left hand as well. The third matter, it is وَلَا تَقُلْ آه. And don't say آه when you're in meaning, don't make a sound. Don't make a sound when you're in. Okay? And this has been narrated in the Riwayah of Bukhari. He also says, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, don't say ha, ha, meaning don't make any sound. It's a prohibition to make any sound when you're yawning. It's from bad etiquette. It is a sound. Because it's a dislike to make a sound when you're yawning, it's a dislike to the people. And you shouldn't do so, it's very ugly. No. Okay. إذا انتهيت إلى مجلس فسلم واجلس حيث ينتهي المجلس، ولا تجلس بين الشمس والظل، ولا تفرق بين اثنين إلا بإذنهما، ولا تقل أحدا من مجلسه، وافسح لمن دخل، واذكر الله فيه، وأقله كفارته، فتقول سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.
ذكر المصنف وفقه الله أبو فاكي منشن من الله عز وجل وجل بيكم. إنسان إذا انتهيت لأين أتكت؟ إذا انتهيت إلى مجلس فسلم. If you come to a gathering, a مجلس, okay, you come to a مجلس, a gathering, and you come whilst the مجلس is going on, it started, okay, and you enter, the first thing you do is you greet أسلم سلام واجلس حيث ينتهي المجلس and sit where the gathering ends. ولا تجلس بين الشمس والظل and don't sit between the sun and the shade. ولا تفرق بين اثنين إلا بإذنهما and do not divide or sit between two individuals except with their permission. ولا تقم أحدا من مجلسه and don't make anyone get up from his seat or his position. وافسح لمن دخل and make space for the one who enters after you. واذكر الله فيه and remember Allah عز وجل in it. وأقله and the least remembrance that you could do if you didn't do any other remembrance, the least is كفارته. كفارة المجلس, expiation of the مجلس الدعاء, you see at the end of the مجلس, which is سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. Okay, you say this at the end, that's the least. And this is the end of now, the مجلس, the gathering. And it has 8 مسائل. It has within it 8 مسائل. المسألة الأولى في قوله إذا انتهيت إلى مجلس فسلم. If you come to a مجلس, then greet. أي إذا بلغت مجلس وصلت إليه فألق السلام على أهله. Okay. It means that if you come to a مجلس while it's going on, then you must greet the people. And the complete form of greeting the people we mentioned early on, which is السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And the second مسألة, it is في قوله واجلس حيث ينتهي المجلس. Sit where the gathering ends. A meaning that you sit where, if the people are sitting together and they're all close together, then ولم تكن العرب يجلس أحد يجلس أحدها في طرف الآخر في طرف والآخر في طرف. The Arabs, what they do is that فإن الناس كانوا إذا جلسوا انضم بعضهم إلى بعض ولم تكن العرب يجلس أحدها في طرف والآخر في طرف. The way they would sit is, the Arabs normally, that they would sit close together. And it wasn't by norms that one would sit in a corner, another one would sit in a corner, etc. But each one would be very close together. And if that's the case, بل كانوا يجلسون متقاربين فإذا جاء أحد إلى المجلس جلس قريبا مما انتهى إليه المجلس. And if someone came, then he would sit very close to them. If it's a circle, where the circle ends, you find a space running to the last person, etc. If it's a circle that people are sitting behind each other all over, and they're very close, he sits at the end where it ends. He does not go over the necks or the shoulders of people to find a space in the front. Unless he's been granted permission by the person who is in charge of the members, which it could be his teacher, or the person whom we have come to, or etc. أما المجالس المتفرقة التي صارت عليها حال الناس فليست مما يجري فيه هذا. As for the gatherings that people are dispersed, then this does not apply to that. This does not apply to that. It applies to the gatherings that people are close together and have filled up all the gaps. But if the people are dispersed and they're sitting all over each of different corners, then this does not apply to that. The مسألة الثالثة, the third matter, it is في قوله ولا تجلس بين الشمس والظل. Do not sit between the sun and the shade. Okay, meaning that some of you is in the shade and some is in the sun. This is has been a prohibition that's been raised on this in Sunnah Ibn Majah, and it's Hadith Hasan. It's a Hadith. It's Hasan. It's Hadith of Sunnah. He prohibited one to sit in between the sun and the wind, the shade. And he says half of him is in the sun and half of him is in the shade. And it's mentioned that some of the people that they mention that the reason for this is because Shaitan sits like this, and everything that's narrated regarding that is weak. Everything that's narrated regarding that Shaitan sits in that way, it is weak. But what we have, it is the prohibition in Sunnah Ibn Majah, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he prohibits him to sit between the sun and the shade. And then we have the fourth mas'ala. في قوله ولا تفرق بين اثنين إلا بإذنهما. The fourth mas'ala, which is do not divide or sit between two individuals except with their permission. The answer it is أن يجلس أحدهما قريبا من الآخر. The order state is that when you come to majlis that everyone is close together. That's the norm. The people are close together. فإذا أريد الدخول بينهما طلب إذنهما. If one wants to sit in between them, then he must seek permission from them. Fil julus, to sit in between them. But if they are far apart and there's a seat in between them, there's a space in between them, then one is not required to seek permission to sit. If they're far apart and they're not close together, and he gets the space for him to sit in between them, and they won't engage in anything that he doesn't have to seek permission to sit in between them. And the fifth mas'ala, it is في قوله ولا تقم أحدا من مجلسه. And do not make anyone get up from his seat or his position. And this is by commanding someone to get up because of the nahi of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, the permission in the hadith of Ibn Abbas. Ibn Umar, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, لا يقيم الرجل الرجل من مقعده. He said that a man is not lawful for a man to make someone get up from his seat. ولكن تفسعوا وتوسعوا. He said, but rather make space and broaden the majlis, the gathering, so people can sit in. But you don't ask someone to get up. It's prohibited. And the mas'ala al-sadith, the sixth matter, it is في قوله وافسح لمن دخل, and make space for the one who enters. Okay? And this is because of what Allah Azza wa Jalla said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ تَفَسَّحُوا فِي الْمَجَالِسِ فَافْسَحُوا يَفْسَحِ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. O you who believe, if it's said to you to make space and broaden the gathering, when whilst you're in the gathering, then فَافْسَحُوا, make space, so Allah Azza wa Jal can make space for you. Meaning in the dunya, Allah Azza wa Jal will make ease for you, and He won't make the dunya ضَيِّقَة, tight on you, and in difficulty. And the making space is of two types. The first type is توسير حسي, يعني you physically making space. Physically making space. Okay? And this is بأن يطيب لهم المقام ويجدوا في جلوسهم راحة فلا يضيق أحدهم على غيره. That's he's physically making space, meaning that he is making a good space for them. That the person, he is comfortable while sitting in that space, okay? And he doesn't squish the other individual, okay? But he gives space that he will be comfortable sitting in. That's the first time. And the second time, it is توسيع معنوي, okay? Untangible space that you're making. Untangible space. Okay? And that is be only before seeking by your nafs being happy by doing this and making the person feel happy when you go out in the space. Once comfortable. Okay? Their nafs are their nafus are comfortable. They're comfortable physically and they're comfortable and mentally sitting there. They're not disturbed by how you reacted. Al-mas'ala al-sabi'a, the seventh mas'ala regarding adab al-majlis, the etiquette of sitting in the majlis. It is بقوله وَذْكُرِ اللَّهَ فِيهِ, and mention Allah Azza wa Jal in it. And this is شَرْعًا وَذْكُرِ اللَّهَ شَرْعًا هُوَ حُضُورِهِ وَشُهُودِهِ فِي الْقَلْبِ وَالْلِسَانِ أَوْ أَحَدُهُمَا. It is Allah Azza wa Jal being present, okay, in your heart and on your tongue, mentioning Allah Azza wa Jal. This is mentioning Allah Azza wa Jal شَرْعًا in the Sharia. And then we have al-mas'ala al-thamida, the last mas'ala, the eighth mas'ala, which is بِقَوْلِهِ وَأَقَلُّهُ كَفَّارَتُهُ. And the least of the dhikr, it is kafaratul majlis. If you haven't mentioned Allah Azza wa Jalla, hold the whole majlis, because from the etiquette of the majlis that you don't remember Allah Azza wa Jalla in any gathering that you go to. If you don't do so, then the least that you can do is after a gathering is finished, you say the kafara of the majlis, which is subhanakallah wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Now,
التاسع أعط الطريق حقا فغط بصرك وكف الأذى ورد السلام وأمر بالمعروف وانهى عن المنكر.
And then the ninth etiquette, it is the etiquette of الطريق, the pathway. The etiquette of the pathway, the street. Okay? He says, أَعْطِ الطَّرِيقَ حَقَّهُ. He says, حَفِظَهُ اللَّهُ, give the path its right. And the right of the path, it is فَغُطَّ بَصَرَكَ, lower your gaze. وَكُفَّ الْأَذَى, and hold back your heart, don't harm anyone. وَرَدَّ السَّلَامُ, and respond to the salam. وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and command or enjoin goodness. وَانْهَى عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, and forbid evil. In this we have the adab of the tariq, the path. And this has five masail matters. Al-ula fi qawlihi a'ti al-tariqa haqqahu. It is, what is the haqq of the tariq? It is the etiquette that you must, the right of the etiquette of the street, it is the etiquette that you must have when you're on the street or the pathway. The etiquette which are coming up. Okay? وَالْأَدَبُ فِي الطَّرِيقِ. Okay, and how do you know it? The etiquette of how you should behave on the street? It is two. And remember, we mentioned earlier where we get etiquette from. We mentioned at the beginning. The Sharia and customs. Okay? Because adab, we said, it is مَا حُمِدَ شَرْعًا وَالْعُرْفَى, what is praised in the Sharia or in the customs of the Muslims. Okay, so he said, وَالْأَدَبُ فِي الطَّرِيقِ إِعْطَاءُ حَقَّهُ أَيْ بَذْلُهُ وَالْقِيَامُ بِهِ. And the adab of the street, it is إِعْطَاءُ حَقِّهِ, giving it its right and making sure that you establish the etiquette on the street. And then what are the etiquettes of the street? The etiquettes of the street, it is in al-mas'al al-thaniya, in the second matter, which is في قوله فغض بصرك, lower your gaze. That's the number one. If you lower your gaze and you don't look at anything, if Allah Number three, the third matter, it is في قوله وكف الأذى, and holding back any harm, not harming anyone. Okay? And that is what it is, harming people with any form of harm, whether it's your speech, whether it's your hand, whether it's anything else, whether it's by you causing harm on the street, etc. And the fourth mas'ala, it is في قوله رد السلام, by responding to the salam. And that's أجب المسلم, it is responding to that salam إذا ألقي عليه السلام. And رد السلام, it is كما تقدم, it is واجب إجماعا, it's obligatory to respond to إجماعا in the consensus like in Abu Dhabi and other than him have mentioned. The fifth mas'ala, the last one, it is في قوله وأمر بالمعروف ونهى عن المنكر, enjoying goodness and forbid evil. Okay, so you enjoy goodness and you encourage others to do good, and if you see people, you encourage them to do good, and if you see evil, okay, then you forbid it and you stop you from doing it. Like the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, he says in the hadith of Sa'id bin Khudri رضي الله تعالى عنه, من رأى منكم منكرا فليغيره بيده وإن لم يستطع فبلسانه وإن لم يستطع فبقلبه وذلك أضعف الإيمان. If one of you sees evil, then he should change it with his hand. If he can't do so, then with his tongue. If he can't do so, then with his heart. And that's the lowest level of iman, and the weakest form of iman. Okay? So the most, the highest level it is to change with the hand if you're able to do so. وحق الطريق المذكور لها خمسة أنواع. The five rants of the street or the pathway, there are five. It is lowering the gaze, okay, holding, refraining from causing harm, okay, رد السلام, responding to السلام, and أمر بالمعروف نهي عن المنكر. Okay, this is mentioned in the hadith of Muslim Khudri in the Sahihain Bukhari Muslim. The five etiquettes or the five rights of that, but here, no.
العاشر إلبس الجميل من الثياب وأفضلها الأبيض ولا يجاوز كعبيك سفلا وابدأ بيمينك لبسا وبشمالك خلعا. تمت الحمد لله.
And the last etiquette, the head etiquette, it is pertaining to أدب اللباس, the etiquette of clothes, of clothing. He says حفظه الله عز وجل وفقه, البس الجميل من الثياب وأفضلها فأفضلها الأبيض ولا يتجاوز كعبيك سفلى وابدأ بيمينك لبسا وبشمالك خلعا. He says wear the most beautiful من الثياب from clothes وأفضلها, the best of it, الأبيض, it is white. And it shouldn't be below your ankles. It shouldn't be below your ankles, that's garment. وَبْدَأْ بِيَمِينِكَ لُبْسًا, and start with the right when you're putting on the clothes. And when you're taking them off, start with the left. This is the etiquette of now clothes that he ends the book with. And it has five masail. It has five masail. And the first mas'ala is في قوله إلبس الجميل من الثياب, wear the beautiful or the most beautiful of your clothes, your clothing, عليكم السلام ورحمة الله, which is a command to, he's commanding us to wear the most beautiful clothes. Okay? And فكل ما يلبس على البدن يسمى ثوبا, everything that is worn on the body, it is called Arabic ثوب. Thawb is not only this that we know as thawb. Everything that is worn on the body in Arabic language is called thawb, which is a garment. وَالْجَمِيلُ مِنَ الثِّيَابِ, and the most beautiful of the garments, it is الْمُسْتَحْسَنْ شَرْعًا أَوْ عُرْفًا, what is known as the most beautiful of the garment, it is what is liked in the Sharia or in customs, the customs of the Muslims, as long as it does not contradict what Islam has approved. What's considered beautiful, okay, of clothes, it is what is liked, shara'an in Sharia, or urfan in the customs of the Muslims, as long as it does not contradict what the Sharia has approved. والمسألة الثانية, the second matter is في قوله وأفضلها الأبيض, and the best of garments it is white, because in the hadith of Umm Salama رضي الله تعالى عنها, and the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, he used to wear a white garment, thobe, and that was his favorite. So it is recommended to wear white because it shows cleanliness. It shows cleanliness, white. فهو المفضل منها شرعا وطبعا فالأبيض سيد الألوان فإن الشريعة اختارته تقديم المأمور به مما يتخذ من الثياب صح بذلك حديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في المسؤول البياض والبياض and it's given preference to white in the Sharia and طبعا even in the nature people they like white okay And this is what the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام referred and is narrated in the Hadith that he's in the Hadith Sahih he said, "In Busul Bayyab, wear white. Wear a command to wear white. So it's recommended. It is mustahab. والملبوس من البياض ما استحسنه مستح استحسنه العرف دون ما استقبحه. And what is worn from white clothing, it is what the customs, what is liked in terms of customs and not what it, what is disliked in terms of Muslim customs. Okay? So what is liked in terms of, okay, customs. وَالْعُرْفُ يَخْتَلِفُ بِاخْتِلَافِ الْأَزْمِنَ وَالْأَمْكِنَ And customs, the custom of the Muslims, it differs depending on time and place. And the area that you're living in and the society that you're living in. Because of those two factors, customs can vary. Customs can vary because of those two factors. Time and place. The area that you're living in and the society that you're living in. Customs, we are always referring to customs of the Muslims and nothing else. And then we have the third mas'ala. The third mas'ala is في قوله ولا يجاوز كعبيك سفلى and it shouldn't go under your ankles, it should be below your ankles. Because that is what the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام he forbid it. In the hadith. And he said صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أسفل الكعبين من النار. Whatever is below the ankles is in the hellfire. طيب. And then we have the mas'ala al-rabi'a. We have the mas'ala al-rabi'a. The fourth matter, which says, وَبْدَ بِيَمِينِكَ لُبْسَا When you are putting on the clothes, you start with the right. Okay, فَيُقَدِّمُهَا عَنْدَ لُبْسِ الثَّوْبِ You start with that when you're wearing the thobe. فِيمَا لَهُ جِهَتَانِ And if it has two sides, for example, it has two hands, you start with the right. If you're wearing trousers, you start with the right leg first, etc. If you're wearing shoes, you start with the right foot first, etc. The fifth mas'ala, which is في قوله وبشمالك خلعا And if you're taking off, you start with that, just like we said, right and left, and you start with the left when you're taking it off. You start with the left when you're taking it off. And what is like in this from clothing, it is everything that is covering the awrah, the sunnah, and what is considered the sunnah clothing, it is everything that covers the awrah. And for the man, the awrah is what is from the belly button to below their knees. This is the awrah. Everything that covers that It is the sunnah clothing, and that the clothes are not tight on the individual, exposing his aura or the shape of his aura. Okay? As long as the clothes are not like that, that clothes is the sunnah clothing that the Sharia encourages one to wear. And the more loose the clothing is, the better. The more loose the clothing is, the better. And this is the end of Al-Adab Al-Ashara, the 10 etiquettes, the general etiquettes of Islam. And the Shaykh Hafidhullah Azza wa Jalla, he mentioned the general etiquettes that we require in every aspect of your life. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to guide us in the best etiquettes. لا يهدي لأحسنها إلا هو ولا يصرف عنها سيئها لا يصرف عنها سيئها إلا هو اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى اللهم أجر نفوسنا تقواها وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.
You know, in the eighth etiquette, one of the marks is
you have a sunnah in the mind of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he prohibited one to sit in between the shade and the sun. I mean, the half of his body is in the sun, it's exposed to the sun, and the other half is under the shade. Okay, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he prohibited that. And that's why it is disliked severely to do so. It is disliked severely, not to haram, but it's disliked severely to do so. Okay, makruh, ashadd al-karah. And there have been statements that mention that the reason why this prohibition is in place is because this is the way Shaytan sits. But all of that was sahih, not authentic.
If you have a garment and it's below your ankles and you're not doing it out of arrogance, is it haram?
This is the matter that the ulama rahimahullah have touched upon, and this is because of the hadith of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was very thin, and his garment went constantly lower down, below his ankle. And you pull it up, and you go down, you pull it up. And the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, he saw this, and he said to him, Ya Bakr, verily you are pulling up your garment, and you're not doing it out of arrogance and pride. So they said that the reason why the prohibition of having the garment under the ankles, the prohibition, it is that it is a sign of pride and arrogance. And if the person is not doing it for pride and arrogance, then he can have his garment under the ankle. However, the ulama that say this word is strictly now specific to Abu Bakr. And it doesn't apply to the rest. It is specific to Abu Bakr, and everyone else must have their garment above the ankle, and that is what is correct. Because of the wa'id, the severe punishment of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he mentioned that whatever is under the ankle or below the ankle, it is in the hellfire. And in the Sharia, we have that what shows that something is haram, prohibited, there are certain signs. And the signs that the statement of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam either